Welcome to Gay Nerd Love.
This is what we talk about when we're not doing it. I'm Archie.
And I'm Andy. And we are coming to you live from Portland, Oregon in the United States of America.
And just a reminder, listeners, this is a podcast for grown-ups, so there will be grown-up language. There, you have been warned.
Yes, so if there's little kiddies about, or if you're easily offended, then you might want to think about not listening.
Exposing them to us.
Yeah, listening later. Watching later.
I'm vamping just a little bit while Andy's going to adjust our first trial. We're very DIY this studio. We just cobble together things. Most things that we've found used or almost everything is used in the studio.
Yeah, I think I have one or two things here that are a gift or something that somebody gave me or brought me. But yeah, pretty much everything that we are going to show today, at least, are things that we scrounged about and found at Goodwill or Salvation Army or some thrift store or Scrap, one of our favorite places in the world here in Portland.
And I was just thinking about, you know, honey, before we went on the air, Andy is super perfectionist, especially when it comes to anything visual. And I'm lazier, I guess, maybe. Mm-hmm. I'm more enthusiastic. I'm just, fuck it, just throw it on the air. I don't care. So, while I'm talking, Andy's adjusting the next visual thing we want to bring to you, because this podcast is not just audio anymore. Occasionally we introduce visual elements. So, we're going to show you a little camera stand.
Well, last week we talked about the potential arrested development of gays, nerds, gay nerds, geeks, and all the implications of that. And this week we're just kind of going the other side and saying, okay, yeah, but that doesn't mean we don't still like, even though we're 250-year-old men, we also, like so many other nerds or fans or children in adult bodies, still like to play, still like to enjoy toys or playthings, as we call them.
Yeah,
because when we say toys, we don't want people to get the wrong idea. We were joking when we were posting on social networking that we were going to do a podcast about toys. It was like, uh-oh, wait a minute, people are going to think we're speaking about the adult kind. And no, this is not a show about adult toys.
I mean, there are toys for adults, but not adult toys, would you say that?
Yeah. This is not going to be about dildos and butt plugs and things like that.
Oh, you just had to say it.
Yeah, I did. So, you know. We've already warned them.
Marital, we used to call them marital.
Marital AIDS.
But let's
right.
move on. All right, so we're just about to bring up a first of our collection. So we have a toy collection in our apartment. There is a top shelf that runs the length of the kitchen, kind of in an L shape, and we store most of our finds on that shelf, and sprinkled throughout the apartment. We also have a robot shelf, a little corner shelf that's devoted solely to robots.
Now, those who have been following the podcast will remember perhaps our podcast about the home for wayward robots that we kind of have created this little orphanage.
Right.
So we have them in their own little place.
So yeah, there are wind-ups, battery-powered ones, some that don't work at all. They just look cool.
Sure.
But not two robots at the moment. So I'm going to bring out the first toy.
So this will be yours. And are we showing the screen yet?
No, I'm going to go to black and then I'll bring it up.
Okay. Archie is also, in addition to co-hosting, he is still the one true crew member we have. That it's just him and me.
And our first toy is... Get him in frame.
Yeah, trying. Yeah, so, oh, that was nice and jerky. So you said him. It doesn't look like a him.
Well,
it
looks like a very masculine queen from Sleeping Beauty. Sleeping Beauty, right?
What was the original kid that we bought?
I always mix up...
Yeah, that was Snow White.
I always mix up Snow White and
I think it's the
Sleeping
Evil
Beauty.
Queen from Snow
You're
White.
Right, Snow White.
Right. Everything looks kind of Queen from Snow White, except for the hands. I mean, look at the hands. The hands are huge.
And why is this? Because,
big reveal.
Ta-da!
It's not really her. Explain what happened. Explain what this is. This is actually a hybrid toy, right?
Yeah, if you have trouble focusing in, but this is a... This is, okay, back, if we go back to the last show, you know, a lot of people, especially as adults, when they buy toys, they get them and they put them in the package, and that's where they stay.
Those are collectors. Those are toy collectors. Those are people not who want to play, who don't want to... I don't think they look at the toys as toys. I think they look at the toys as investments or as things like stamps or coins.
Now, this man does not look happy to be dressed as...
He's looking at you. He's looking at me. He's like, what? What are you saying?
The backstory on this costume, I'll put it in his hand here.
See, a collector would never...
A collector would never take it apart.
First of all, never use the toy or play the toy.
The costume and the mask came as part of a flat kit where you can dress up any... 10 to 12 inch doll as the
essentially a Barbie doll usually
as the evil
you turn
queen.
Barbie you could turn Barbie into the evil queen
yeah from is it Snow White
yeah I think so
Snow okay the evil queen from Snow White
whatever
like oh Mirror Mirror and all that
yeah
but this I just thought it was funny to take a male doll and
put her in Disney drag.
And the expression on his face is perfect. I mean, he's like totally pissed off that he has to wear that. He had little purple pumps that I don't know what happened to them, but his feet
I hate it when I lose my purple pumps.
Them anyway.
Yeah, actually, I took pictures while you were taking and swapping out the costumes and made this little photo essay.
Yeah, there's part two of this story.
There is a part two of this,
but
yes.
But I just wanted to bring him out there and show just how... How much I've upset him.
He's trembling with rage. Well, but what's the original doll? The male doll? You didn't explain that, did you?
Oh, the original male... Okay.
I can explain
the original male doll, and then a little later, how he got into this outfit.
Right. So, as you can see, this doll might look vaguely familiar, although he doesn't actually have the true likeness of any of the members, but it is...
It is a doll from, I don't know if I can get this in here, the movie 13. Apollo 13.
We found this at Goodwill, I believe, did we not?
We did.
It's probably still got like an advertisement. See, there's the Astro backpack thing, whatever. But, you know, it's like from the hit movie.
Yes, but I don't recognize that doll as resembling any of the three leads in the film.
I think he's kind of got... A little bit of Kevin Bacon, a little bit of Bill Paxton, but not very much Tom Hanks. I'm not seeing any Tom Hanks in here.
Maybe he's pissed off because he doesn't look like any of them.
Or maybe he's Gary Sinise. He's pissed off because he didn't get to go on the trip at all, remember.
Right.
So maybe it's supposed to be Gary Sinise. But yeah, what's interesting is he doesn't have the typical Ken doll face.
No.
He's got a G.I. Joe body of sorts. Sure. But no. But it's just, it's perfect that he just looks pissed as hell that he's being forced to look like her.
I think I heard a sing rip when I crammed him into this outfit.
So. I think you did.
All right, so that's my first one. And we'll go back to black while you bring out your next.
Okay. Now, my first presentation of today will be something that somebody brought back to me from Russia back in the 1990s.
It's an actual Russian.
This is an actual. Well, you just told them what it was.
Oh. Sorry.
Is it? Oh, are we streaming now?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know if we were gone out of black yet or not.
Yes.
Okay.
This is the best.
Okay. This was actually given to me by Dwell. If you're listening, Dwell, shout out to you. Who was in Russia studying the Russian language, and he and I were both huge Star Trek fans. We would watch Next Gen and Deep Space Nine and all that. And so he was in Russia, and he found this probably at a street mart or something. And what I love about this is that this is a Russian nesting doll, and it's a not quite, it says Star Trek, But you're seeing that this is supposed to be the likeness of Shatner, right?
It's Russian Shatner.
It's Russian Shatner. And then there's the Enterprise ED? I mean, you can't, it's like this kind of strange, warped version of the Enterprise. But you open up, inside Kirk is, of course, Mr. Spock.
Spock was inside Kirk.
Yes, Spock was inside Kirk. And so here we have Mr. Spock, you know, and all that. And he looks about as pissed as the other doll does, of course. So that's Kirk, and then we
very open. Angular.
Yes, very angular. Inside Kirk, and inside Spock, of course, is McCoy. So here we have McCoy.
They all look pissed off.
They all look really pissed off. Well, they're Russian. So yes, and so we open up McCoy, and there's Worf, who is not even in the same series. It's like no, it shouldn't. It should be like Sulu or Uhura or something like that. So it's kind of like I have a feeling this was made by a craftsperson who didn't really know the series that well. So we'll find out what's inside Worf. So open Worf. Inside Worf is Geordi.
Hey, so you get two series in one.
So yeah, this is a physical true mashup.
But you don't get Picard.
You don't get Picard. You don't get Uhura.
Worf,
you don't. I don't understand. But I treasure this.
Okay.
I have had this all these years now. This is one of those things where I don't play with this doll, or like, you know, this isn't the kind of thing like Archie did with Apollo 13 and did something kind of fun with it. This is just something I display as a curio keepsake of my good friendship with Dwell, who still lives in Seattle. And just, I mean, how many times have you seen a Russian nesting doll of Star Trek? So.
Never.
That's why it's
this would be now.
So this is an atypical example of our collection.
I like how Star Trek, this is like someone painted into the last minute.
They aren't even trying. I mean, look, it's like they ran it, like they re-inked the R, and then the Trek is just like the rest of the paint. It's just like they were cleaning their brush. So that is my first presentation.
That was a good one.
What's next? As they say on the West Wing.
Okay, well.
Your turn.
Before I lose the thread of my first presentation.
Oh, yes. This is kind of the other half of it, right?
This is
because
the
course,
other half of it.
Of course, now the to be clear, the Apollo 13 astronaut did not come in the box dressed as the queen from Snow White or Cinderella, whichever it is.
No.
So that means that he was wearing something else. And what was he wearing?
Well, we'll just bring it up. He was wearing this spacesuit.
It's very stylish.
I like it. I like the little pockets on the side.
Little pockets. Got little pockets. Got little gloves.
Little gloves. And the helmet.
And boots. These look like those workman boots that were really popular in the gay world in like 1990-something, right? Or late 1980s.
Well, I don't know.
But this does not appear to be an astronaut, Archie.
It is not.
Or I'm sorry. It does not appear to be a member of the Apollo 13 crew.
No.
Correct?
I'm sitting him down so you could... Well, sitting the character down.
Sitting the doll. The action figure doll down.
Because if you tilt up the helmet...
That's a woman. What woman is this?
What? And you remove the helmet.
For the reveal.
It's Brooke Shields.
It's the Brooke Shields.
America's most glamorous teenager.
Archie and I had a seizure of laughter when we found the Brooke Shields action figure at Goodwill, was it not?
This is another case where we just... happened upon something that wasn't hugely collectible, but is in the collectible world.
It probably is, yeah.
And Goodwill's usually pretty, unfortunately, you know, they're wise to it now, and their people research...
they got a website.
They research Google, and they find out, what can we get for this?
Oh, so I think they didn't put this out there because the box was just bashed to shit. So they knew that you know, this is... very likely not going to be collectible in the, you know, it's in this kind of shape. But just, this is the most wonderful...
Now, I just wanted to show the box, because yes. I have to show you what was in the box. You can leave her there.
Okay, well, let's put her back here where she can just Mommy says I can relax.
You get a signed photo of Brooke Shields.
Yes, look at that. It's autographed by Brooke Shields herself. Look at that. Real lithography.
You get, it looks like an Angora sweater.
I think, yes, it's an Angora sweater. So,
or sweats or something.
Well, correct me if I'm wrong, wasn't the first thing we did with the Apollo 13 guy was to have him swap outfits and you put him in the Angora sweater?
Oh,
and he looked really good.
He looked really
good. He looked
pissed.
Angrier, I swear. And look, she even has a little ring, a pinky ring, you can wear if you want, or you can put it, I guess, as an arm cover.
Well, he was furious at Brooke Shields, and she said, Mommy says I can wear the spacesuit.
Mommy says I get to be an astronaut.
Mommy bought this spacesuit for me.
Mommy says I get to join NASA.
He said, Shields!
Shields!
Now, this... I could, I had thought for a fleeting...
Back in the helmet. Back in the helmet. Yep. Hush.
For a fleeting moment, I thought of swapping them back.
Yeah.
And but I get so much joy. I leave Brooke in the Apollo 13 box. And then...
Yeah. We swap them out. We have Brooke in the... When we display it, if you see on the web, on the, I think it's the Facebook page that we have the arrangement of fun, or else it's on Twitter. One of the two social media. You can see the on the cover photo. You can see Brooke in the Apollo 13 box, and I don't know if she's all that that comfortable either doing the mashup that we're doing.
But it makes me laugh. It makes me laugh to see him so pissed off as the queen, and it makes me laugh to see her as an astronaut.
Yeah, I think she really missed her calling there, because you know, designer jeans and astronaut suits, why not?
So you should queue up your next toy. Now, okay. There's going to be, we haven't gotten around to things that make sound yet. Mm-hmm. So it's probably, I'm directing right while I'm looking at you, is to make the sound first and then put the thing on camera. Okay, good.
Yeah.
All right, cool.
So the next thing we're going to hear and then show is one of my favorite finds. I found this at Goodwill. And it was in the toy section, and it just, I looked at it and I thought, this looks kind of sad, because it's just, because I picked it up and this is an old, broken down music box that, like, this little toy for like babies or kids, but clearly somebody has either overcranked it or overused it or whatever, and it's got this like slightly odd sound that, like, when I crank it like that, you hear it like this. So what we decided is this would be like the crazy music. Whenever we see a crazy character in a television show, we'll just start going, and it becomes the theme music for someone who's crazy. And so you didn't want me to buy this. You were like, oh no, this is like overpriced. I think it was like $2. And you're like, no, it's not worth it. Why? And then I persisted. I'm really glad I did.
Because I think you explained where you'd use it. And then I sort of pictured it in my head. And said, yes. Okay, that worked.
So yes. So that's my multimedia presentation.
We actually keep that near
near the television.
So actually, by the couch.
Who was it that the theme for the longest time?
It was for Queen Quinthrith on Vikings.
Yes, the show Vikings.
The crazy horny queen. Crane.
True.
All right, so if we're gonna go for sound, since we're in that universe,
since we're in that medium,
I'm gonna make the sound first and then show the thing.
What on earth is that? Okay, it sounds electronic.
Right? And it is... This is a toy for... I assume it's for toddlers?
Yes, but we don't let that stop us.
Maybe to amuse babies?
Perhaps. Yeah, it's very Teletubby-esque.
And... You happen to point out that it's... Mouth looks like an anus.
It does. It looks like a knitted anus. It's like
a singing anus.
Yeah, see, it's got the striations, is what I'm talking about.
Like the teeth. I didn't notice the teeth inside.
Yeah, it's got a tooth in it.
I forget what it is. I forget what the actual name is, but I know that I did read that if you have more than one, they will harmonize.
Wow.
We've got to find another
one. And we keep looking. Now that we're not looking, we can't find one. When I wasn't looking for them, they were all over the place in Goodwill. Now that I'm looking for one, I can't find one.
Yeah, exactly.
But I want at least two so they can...
So they can have a conversation? Or they have a choir or a music group?
Yes.
Yes.
Now, it's something we're not going to show, but it's just something that brought to mind. We have... You bought this wonderful and this wonderful Buddha with a plasma globe on top of it.
Yeah, I was going to show that. That's what she does after you don't play with her for like more than a minute. She says so long. It's like a toy that starts saying, "Hey, you're supposed to play with me." So yes.
And but it's an interesting plasma experiment because if you put this toy and some other electronic toys over a plasma globe, they'll stop.
It'll mess with the electronics inside.
They'll stop working, or they'll make crazy sounds. It's true.
It's true. In fact, I will present a toy that we've done that with because it quite wonderfully does make a very wrong sound. This was at Goodwill for like $5 or $7. And we were like, oh my God, you're kidding. So we brought it home. We cleaned all of the corrosion off of the...
Yeah, the battery compartment was corroded.
So I think everybody thought, oh, well, then it doesn't work, right?
Right.
So
now you, in your trek nerddom, pointed out that the scale is wrong.
It's true.
But look at this. We got a it's sort of a tabletop display enterprise. It makes noise and lights up.
It's true.
The price tag's still on it. We haven't touched it. Oh, you didn't put the sound first.
It sounds a bit drunk, doesn't it? Yes, the weaker the batteries get, the weirder that Shatner starts to sound.
Yes, that was supposed to be William Shatner. But, oh, no, because the batteries die and it just fucking gets... Oh, shit. Yeah, we heard. Wait.
Well, I was trying to show them the lights.
Oh, no,
if you want to turn off the slow rotation. If you want to turn off the other light there.
Will they show up?
The lights. That it's to see. Yeah, see, the thing lights up and blinks. And
how cool is that?
It's just, yeah, sometimes every once in a while you will simply turn off the lights and like fly this around the apartment like you used to when you were like 12 and like cool, all that kind of stuff. So yes, the nacelles light up, the bridge lights up.
And the shuttle bay light.
Yeah, the shuttle bay light, which is, just like blinking. That's just like, you know, I would have like peed my pants over this as a child.
But we were saying about the also the plasma globe is that if you put that over the plasma globe, it just goes
yes.
We just record that and just post it.
We should, just as a sound file.
That was I don't know. I mean, it's just a cute little model, but I just like looking up at it and know that we have, you know, that we have this thing.
You didn't have to build it.
That is collectible. It's like numbered or something.
It is. In fact, but then, you know, it's kind of one of those situations where something says real collectible, it usually isn't, but in this, I guess, is, and it's like supposed to be some 50th anniversary tie-in. But, I'm just delighted to have it. So what do we have next? Oh, I hear sound. Is that Bill Shatner? No, this is not a Star Trek sound. Oh, yep, it does that, doesn't it?
His feet are stuck, and that's why I got it for a discount.
It's a Techno T-Rex.
The T-Rex kit, yes.
Yes.
And the,
Yeah, he gets stuck from time to time, like we all do. It's coming at you. Must go slower.
But it's pretty cool. Especially when you get...
The eyes glow.
When you get robot kits like this, there's always... The the possibility that they're going to break, or that they're already broken. They're missing one crucial part.
The one part that the kid broke, or the one part that the kid took apart. Yes, it's true. So this is some part of our robot.
Home for Wayward Robots.
Home for Wayward Robots, right, exactly. We'll just let him walk right off. That's right off screen. He's Grandpa Robot. He's the one that didn't survive.
He's got bunions.
Well, now we know why they didn't survive. I mean, they can't even move.
That was fun.
It was.
Okay, let me...
So, if we're going to do robots...
Yes.
Okay. This robot, I believe, was brand new. I think did we buy this brand new, or did we buy this at Goodwill?
I bought that brand new for you at Target.
Yes. And you to this day, absolutely love my response to this.
Well, I was in the bathroom. I had to run in the bathroom. It was like...
We're old.
Old. Like, it wasn't the most... graceful the presentation. It's like, here, honey, here's a gift for you. Oh, shoot, I gotta go to the bathroom. But while I'm in the bathroom, I hear, oh!
And that is because I had activated this thing. Because, as you will see...
Oh, I hope that wasn't too loud for you guys.
Okay. That's the sound it makes. And here's the... Holy shit!
it's a robot tick.
Oh, it's just... It looks like it's just the worst thing. See, it just...
It's so fucking crazy.
This thing is just trying to survive so hard. This is one of those, bugs?
What do they call them? Hex bug.
Yeah, hex bugs.
Oh, it's nightmarish.
See, it is nightmarish. It's like a Xanti misfit on meth.
Now, they called it a scarab. I had never seen one in operation, so I didn't know it was this frantic when I bought it.
But I didn't realize it was going to scare the shit out of me. Or bring back, like, spider or insect phobic response from me.
But look at that thing.
This thing coming right at you.
It's aggressive.
It is aggressive.
Oh, and it acts like a bug.
It does. It does. Well, we have video somewhere. I think it's on the Facebook page of all of our little hex bug robots at once. And right. this was like scurrying all over the stove and, like, you know, generally getting in the way.
Oh,
I love how this thing can ride itself. So? Yeah, look at that. This thing would definitely survive. See, minutes of fun to be had. It's like slain in the Holy Spirit or something. There, you turn it off.
You don't want to touch it.
No.
Oh, yeah, and...
Yes, nightmarish.
I'm sorry.
We should put the evil queen head on it and let it run around like a Xanti misfit from the Outer Limits. So what's next on your toy shelf?
On my toy shelf? Well...
What's next on your toy shelf?
I'll go back to robots, but for a moment I'm going to do something a little different. Here's another toy that makes sound. So hopefully you guys can hear this.
I'm not a program. My name is Sam Flynn.
And I'm in a shitty sequel.
Some things are worth the risk.
I love voice.
We gotta work together.
Toys. Oh, now that's porny.
Where am I? Am I on the grid?
So what is it?
I think I cycled through all of them.
I think you did.
This is, as you said, this is Sam Flynn from the shitty sequel to Tron Legacy.
Hello.
There he is. He's got his identity disc.
He's got his identity disc. And when you were activating him, it's this button back here, right?
It's on the side.
Oh, it's on the side.
Under his armpit.
That's weird.
There you go. He lights up. I wish his whole uniform lit up.
And look how his face lights up.
Yeah.
So you can actually see there's like this little, like...
It's,
Tron face.
And I think it's interesting what they've done there. I think it's just two states of an image, kind of like a lenticular thing, and the blinking light makes it look like
he's
talking.
Yeah, it does. You can't really see if you can turn the angle of that light, because it's... Actually, just turn that light off.
I'll turn it down.
Yeah, so it looks like he's talking. Mm-hmm. It's really, really fast. I'm surprised it's technology that wasn't used in other toys. Because it really does work in a strange way. In fact, you know what it made me think of? It made me think of the future alien or future robotic creatures in AI. They had that kind of face, but it looked like it was like the inside of a flashbulb or something and all of that.
So. Oh, when the face came off?
No, at the very end of the movie, they looked like they were flashbulb kind of creatures that were all wispy,
yes.
And they had that kind of
the alien thing.
They had like a projected-looking... Yes, totally.
So, yeah, that's my sense.
Thank you. Take your bows.
The second best thing about the movie.
The second best. What was the best thing about the movie?
IMAX.
Jude Law?
IMAX 3D.
Okay. I can see that, yeah.
And now it is Andy's turn.
Okay, and so...
I guess I think we can stop introducing to each other. It's just the two of us. It's the other, right?
That's true. So, here we have what appears to be a simple Borg cube. Well, there are no simple Borg cubes, but this is I think a Micromates, or one of those, like... franchises of toys.
Oh, it's like Playmates?
Yeah.
They cranked out tons of TNG products.
Yeah. So at first it looks like this is simply a Borg cube, and it is a Borg cube. But what I love about this thing, I've had this forever. I've had this since, like, I think the 90s. And you open it up, and inside is like this little miniature fold out.
That is cool.
Yes. There's like, you get a little tiny Borg. See, he's coming for you.
You will be assimilated. Your service.
And then little tiny...
Oh my gosh! Picard. That's the best thing. Locutus.
Pre-Locutus. He's not Locutus yet.
Oh, because he's not...
He's still Picard. Oh. And so, you see you get this little bio-bed looking thing. And you can, like, and it's even got this little head extension thing right there.
Is that where, like, Picard goes?
Yes, and you put Picard, like, right on there.
Before he's transformed, probably.
Get some light. Light's too low.
Yeah.
And there. And then you can, like, look, they can even have wars, Cordy T. And you can put them right there. And it's like, not one thing. Yeah. But anyway. You can see, you can get, like, the idea here that you've got a little chamber, and Picard's like, no.
You know what I like? Come here, you know what I like?
Yeah, exactly. So this could be, like, Borg dungeon fantasy or
Borg
something.
Borg porn.
Right. I just love it because I just love tiny little things like this.
Now, I'm surprised.
And then you can just kind of fold it all up.
It almost, it's a little too sophisticated to be one of those Happy Meal toys.
Yeah, it's not a Happy Meal toy.
I'm surprised...
Oh, they're going at it.
At the size of the figures, because, you know, they always warn about small parts and choking hazard. So,
yeah.
Was this for kids at all?
Yeah, it was for kids. It was just, like, you know, probably 12 and up or something like that. So, but I've had that on display forever. I just love that little thing.
The tiny, tiny Picard.
Teeny little Picard.
Those look HO scale. Those figures, by the way. You know,
yeah.
Like railroad scale.
You know, that might be. It's possible. Yeah, maybe we can integrate them into our, like, train set that we're planning on building for the perimeter.
Now, I asked you about this because I wanted to sort of expand the definition of toy. Are models considered toys?
Sure.
They
because are? You can play with them.
Okay.
Because I used to, like, put them right up to my eye and then, like, run around the yard or the apartment or whatever when I was a kid, pretending that, you know, it was like the point of view of the spaceship and whatever. So, yes.
And this is, I'm going to frame it here. You hold it. This is another example of something that is collectible that we found, that we actually took out of the box and started to play with. Started
to make use of. Of course, this is, I think, the Klingon cruiser. But yeah, this is the Klingon cruiser of the battle type from Star Trek: The Motion Picture, and then on.
Oh right.
So this is not from the original series.
Right. Yeah. Well, you can tell. I mean, that's much has much more detail on it. I love the design of this ship.
Yeah, you can see the detail. I've done the base paint in a flat gray, and then we're gonna do much more detailed of the, as you can see, the plating and all that. There's a guide that I accidentally threw away when I tossed the box. The only piece that was missing was the part to go inside there. So I'm thinking of trying to just put a light in there, which would be really cool.
Oh, like what color is there of the Klingon photons? Red.
Red.
Right.
Yes. There's the Klingon anus.
How are you going to do the? Are you going to make a stencil? And are you going to paint the...
I probably will mark off the areas that I don't want to paint with tape and then paint what's not taped.
Oh, that's easy.
Probably something like... Actually, it's a lot of work. But
oh, because each individual plate... Yeah.
Each individual section that's going to be in different colors. Yeah.
This is one of the rare not Goodwill finds. We got these as part of... We bought like three kits from a church basement sale.
A church rummage sale that they... I don't think they knew what they had.
For what we paid.
We just had these little geek orgasms and saw it and grabbed them and like, buy it.
For people who do go out to sales and stuff and have to bargain and negotiate, you know when you find something in the yard sale, garage sale, or rummage sale that you know has some value to you or has some collectible
value or actual value.
You give the poker face.
You try not to look as excited.
You try not to...
We were trying to like...
To cover your pants.
Yeah, we were really trying to hide that.
And then you say, what would you take for it? Oh, give me a couple of bucks.
Yeah, I think we got these for like... I think we got three kits for $10 or something absurd like that.
And, they were... You know, cause some kits you buy and like people started to build them and then discarded them.
That's common.
These were pristine.
Right. Totally.
And I can't wait till. Didn't you say that once you paint this, we're going to hang it from fishing line or something?
Of course we are.
Okay.
Of course we are. We will figure out some way to display it properly. What do I have now?
Yeah, we just got that Klingon ship, and we got a couple other model kits that I'm going to get around to. Like, there's a Ferengi Marauder that I'm not exactly excited about the Ferengi Marauder as a ship, which is why I haven't gone into into it. Blah blah blah. And now,
one of my oldest toys. This was purchased by me in a box when it was first on shelves, so that would have been late 1980s, maybe early into my college. Like, actually, probably mid-late, like 87, 88, I think. And this, there were two types of Pee Wee Herman dolls, and there was the talking and the non-talking. And this is one of the talking dolls, but I have not tried to make this thing talk in a long time.
This is analog, right? This is pre-digital.
I think so. It probably doesn't work, but... So this is what it sounds like. Yep.
It sounds like a mouse.
So if I control the speed...
Uh-huh. It comes for you in your dreams, it sounds like. Hey!
Yes, in fact, I'm planning on using this doll to pose with the mini pinball machine that I'm building. In fact, I'm going to try and build it to scale so that I can pose the doll with the pinball machine.
Yeah, from this angle, he looks like Alan Cumming, the actor.
You know, it really does. I wonder if he realizes that he actually does look like a relative of Pee Wee Herman.
The Tron Digital thing was funny, mm-hmm. fun. But something about those analog voice boxes they had.
I love those.
Because it was a little record player inside.
It was a little
plastic record.
Right, they didn't take batteries. Didn't need batteries. Didn't corrode, so there's nothing to corrode or whatever.
And even the battery powered ones was still a little plastic record and a little needle in.
Right. It wasn't a tape. Digital. Now it's digital.
Yeah. So it was a little lost about that.
Which is why you can mess with it with the globe, with the electronic globe.
But I didn't know he talked. I think that's the first time you pulled
I don't think I pulled that string in 15, 20 years. It's true. So now it's your turn. Thanks, Pee-wee.
See you later.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah, there you can see him next to the lunch pail given to me by Lisa Barnett, Lisa Faye Barnett, who was my very first college roommate and who loved, along with me, loved Pee-wee Herman. So just when she came to visit Portland a couple of years ago or a year ago, she gave me that Pee-wee Herman lunchbox. So, and then I think that little pterodactyl action figure next to it, I don't know if that's actually an official Terry the pterodactyl for the Pee-wee Herman or not. But we put it next to him anyway.
It looks close enough, right?
Works for me.
All right, so I guess you consider this a toy. It's more like, maybe it's more like a collectible.
I think it's probably a collectible.
Oops. That's how you get tilted up. So, yes. We cannot believe that anyone got rid of this. This is a Cirque du Soleil acrobat, and it's actually one
it's
of three.
Kit, and it's a kit of acrobats that are magnetic. So you can put them in these, like, arrangements.
That I don't know you can do.
I don't think you can do that, but...
But we have them on top of our freezer, as you can see, you'll see back in the static image. But yeah, I guess they use those super magnets that I can never remember the name of.
Mm-hmm.
But they're
they just look gay as hell. They just look gay as hell. They really do. And so we pose them on our refrigerator all the time.
Change them around. Yeah, even the rings they're holding are also magnetic, so you can... And I just realized the top of his head is magnetic, too.
Yep. So you can, like, put him, like...
Stand him on his head.
Uh-huh. You can stand him up and then have someone else, like...
Like that guy?
Like this. You know, like in our wilder days. You can do that.
Yes.
In fact, that's probably how they're supposed to be.
Sure.
Like presented.
Yeah, there's probably a way of, you know, if we.
There's probably a proper way to do this, but we never do things
properly. To put all three of them together.
Yeah. But where's the fun?
But for gay people, how would you give? It must have been straight people who gave these away because
this is a gay toy that nobody would ever get rid of. You're kidding me. But yes. They do tend to fall off the fridge every once in a while if we slam the freezer too fast, but so what's next? Let's see.
Oh.
I think you almost forbade me from buying
it. I almost forbade you from I don't have veto power on things. At least I don't want to try to do that.
We can do a reveal here.
Okay. You ready?
Uh-huh. So she looks like a Barbie doll.
It looks like your average female doll
I've got her on a little presentation stand or whatever, but who is it actually? Who does it look like?
I don't know what it looks like. To me, it looks a little like, Laura Dern.
Maybe? Yeah, or whatever. But no, boys and girls... It is actually none other than, it's the Ann Coulter action figure. It is one of America's real action heroes. And it talks.
Ugh.
I almost bought the other one. We found this at Goodwill. I almost bought the other one. The other one was the Dennis Miller doll, just to see what he would say. But sure enough, good old Anne here. Because, you know, you can't stop her from speaking. She just has to weigh in on everything. So let me see if I can remember how to make her talk. She's got her hair, but see, her hair is still all, like, pulled together in this, like, plastic ponytail thing, and so...
Yes. Maybe if she loosened her hair, it released some of the tension in her face.
Maybe it would.
I stole that line.
I'm going to pull this off screen now and see about getting her to talk.
They hate America. They hate flag wavers. They hate abortion opponents. They hate all religions except Islam.
Oh, you put the box up while you're having her talk.
They don't have the energy. If they had that much energy, they'd have indoor plumbing by now.
Oh.
She just says hateful things. It's a doll that says hateful things.
Liberals have reinvented the master race, and it is their own hip selves. At the risk of giving away the ending, it's all liberals' fault.
Please continue, Anne.
Tell us more,
Enlighten
Anne.
Us with your wisdom.
Most devastating for the left as a cohesive political movement was the collapse of their beloved Soviet Union.
Oh.
Just hateful. Stupid and hateful and wrong.
Swing voters are more appropriately known as the idiot voters because they have no set of philosophical principles. By the age of 14, you're either a conservative or a liberal if you have an IQ above a toaster.
No, I never listened
to her. This is Ann Coulter, independent voters.
I've never listened to her. Now, did they just sample this from stuff she's already said, or did she record just for this doll?
I can't. That last one sounded like it was from something else, but the other sounded like she recorded it just for this doll. I'd be curious to know.
Swing voters are the people who really do choose the leader of the free world on the basis of whether he wears boxers or briefs.
She might actually be right there, unfortunately.
Consider that the leading Democrat argument against Bush's tax cut was to demand to know how exactly it would help anyone. To state the manifestly obvious, people would have more money. Liberals are so blocked on the idea that people's money should be their own, they can't see the big fat reward. More money.
See, she just goes on
Liberals
and on.
Liberals hate religion, but politics is a religion something
that
they hate fairly competition.
Now that there's no more Bush administration, you don't hear as much from her. At least I don't.
Oh, she's been
active.
She's dating Jimmy Walker now, by the way.
I heard that. Jimmy Walker from Good Times.
It's true.
It's not an accident that today, the left's single biggest cause is global warming. This time, conservatives won't be able to prove them wrong for 1,000 years.
And she'll be long, long dead. So.
Oh, and.
Anyway. That's the Ann Coulter action figure. Enough from her.
Now I kind of wish you had bought the Dennis Miller.
Yeah, I know. Because God knows what he has to say. But I do have her proudly displayed along with a very gay-looking G.I. Joe doll, which I'm not bringing in today. Maybe next time I do this, I'll bring it. But I kind of have her in this like political stasis chamber where I can kind of keep her where I can see her. And I will give them credit for putting a really good voice chip in there. And the likeness is pretty good. That's not a bad doll in terms of what she looks like. I mean, well, yeah. Let's give her horror movie lighting here, or Kirk light here. That just she's kind of coming for you.
I don't really know her, but I guess
what?
Yeah. I guess.
What? What?
I'm sorry, Anne. I don't know who you are.
No, I'm glad you don't know as much. I know too much about her, and I've heard too much of her. And, you know, I know that Bill Maher loves to have her on the air because they're friends and because she always gives great copy and whatever, but that's the problem. That's exactly what she traffics in, and I think she's just, you know, all she wants is attention. And here I am giving her unneeded attention, so shame on me.
Yeah, there are not to get too off track here, but there are a lot of, a political narcissist that says stuff solely to get
Tony Lauren. Totally. And there are people on the left who do the same thing.
Oh, for sure.
To be fair.
All right.
But I think it's funny. People jokingly asked me if I was going to use it as a voodoo doll, and I'm like, no, because I don't believe in magic. But yeah, it's clever. And obviously these were made not for leftists like me, but for the opposite. They were made for, you know, right-wing people to have their own action figures and all that, so. So anyway, what's next?
Well, this is a bit of endless fun. I'll just call it that. It's so bright that it kind of blows out on the camera, but check this.
Yes.
This is...
And it's not quite as white as it looks on the camera. It's actually
it's green.
Bright green.
And this is a plasma toy that we got from
Wunderland.
Wunderland. It is a place that's a movie theater and arcade. And the arcades is full of these redemption games where you get tickets and you exchange the tickets for a particular different toys.
Right.
This is by far one of the best toys
this
we've
is the
ever.
Best thing we ever got
yeah, it's the best thing we ever got.
It really is.
It is a clip-on plasma disc.
Yes, and we got several of them, and this would be like perfect for like a Borg.
Oh my gosh!
Cosplay
is that just a visual artifact? Because it looks like there's plasma coming off the edge of it. It sits on the camera. If you aim it at the camera, it looks like there's plasma coming off into your hand and off the edge,
look at that.
Off the edge of the screen.
Yes, look at that. That is trippy. Minutes of fun to be had.
But wait, there's more. You know, besides the, you know, the... For one thing, I love plasma. There's the whole concept of it. There's this gas that emits light when, you know... Mm-hmm. But I want to take it away and then... Actually, I think I can do the switch with one hand.
What else does it do?
It has another feature.
It's so voice activated.
It's voice... So, yes. We can stay away from... Back up off the mic and talk a little louder and...
Resistance is futile.
You will be assimilated. You will service
you,
us.
You will service us.
Or...
So I can imagine a queen just wearing these all over her body and dancing the night away.
Well, yeah, I bet people go to... Although we haven't seen them at conventions, I'll bet people go and any music that's playing in the background, this thing will flash the beat.
I don't know about you, but do you remember that speaker-sized light that would respond to music and sound that was sold in the 1970s? It looked like a speaker box, and it would light up, and it had like a piece of plastic that diffused the light.
Right, and it had Christmas lights inside of it, right?
No, it just had a couple of lights in, like three or four, but they were kind of like prismatically. They were the shapes. You remember how fogged or smoked glass in bathrooms would sometimes have a pattern to it, so that if you showed a light through it, it would make the light into a giant diamond.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what this had.
No, it had that prismatic plastic. Right. I always thought it was Christmas lights inside, because I never... That was one of the things I'm surprised I didn't try to take apart.
True. So, yes. The Borg light. A lot of Star Trek-themed stuff here, I'm noticing. Not an accident.
No. Big Trek fans.
Well, let's throw a bone, then, to the Star Wars fans. Now, Archie and I are not huge Star Wars fans. We like Star Wars. We don't love Star Wars. We hate the prequels. We think Empire is the best thing, like, ever Star Wars-wise, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Except for the one time... Actually, when Star Wars came out, I was like a really intense Star Wars fan for maybe the first few years after Star Wars came out. Mm-hmm. I've seen every movie. I've stood in line for the original trilogy. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, then the prequels kind of ruined it for me. And then I just, you know, lost interest until Rogue One.
Oh.
And I will only see Star Wars films directed by the director of Rogue One.
Okay.
Because that felt more like Star Wars to me than anything else.
But, well, I don't remember where we found this. I think we found this at Goodwill. It's a little bitty, as you can see, for size comparison. It's very similar to the Borg cube in size.
I wonder if it's made by the same people.
Probably, but it says Tatooine on it, of course. And then if you push this little button right here, let me get the light so it's not quite so direct, you open it, and there's a laser battle going on in there, and I think the laser battle is...
Is that Liam Neeson?
I think, I don't know if this is, well, let's see. Yeah, I think it is. Because if you look at the background, I think they have the big silver Millennium Falcon, the one from the prequels. I think this is like it's Darth Maul and Liam Neeson are like having, but they have a really short battle.
It's only one
because,
one
because this is the thing that winds it up. It's the closing of this. So that basically, and it's over.
Now,
I just like it because it's Maul and it moves.
I was fascinated. I mean, for a time, I was collecting. Do you remember those eggs that were the same thing? They were egg-shaped, and you would open them up, and there was a whole scene inside, like an underwater scene where fish would swim.
Yeah.
And so it's the same mechanism.
Right.
But it's themed to this battle.
Okay. Or already. And it was probably at Goodwill because it was a prequel thing.
Right. Oh, the prequel stuff.
There's a lot of prequel merch at Goodwill.
At Goodwill.
Still.
Yeah, he lost a lot of Goodwill with the prequels. Right.
So let's see what What else do you want? Do you want to do the sound first on this one?
Yes, I'll do the sound first.
So we have...
It'll be pretty obvious what it is.
Yes. You can make its thing. I don't know how to turn it on.
Is the battery dead?
That would suck. I handed it to you.
Oh, no. I think the battery might be dead. I think I left the battery on. Damn it.
Well, let's show them what we're trying to make work.
Oh, I think I left the battery on. That's so sad. Oh, there it is. What were you saying? What? What was that?
I think when you move it, when you move it around.
I think it has a sensor. It has a sensor, but I couldn't tell you where it is.
No, I think it's light.
You're right. It's light.
Yeah. This is just surreal. It's like one of those "Do you like our owl" moments from Blade Runner. It's this thing actually is like a robot bird, and it looks a lot like a bird, and it sounds a lot like a bird.
It does. It was missing its little feet, but
it lost it in the war.
I just love it. It reminds me of the like a really basic version of the Disney animatronic bird.
Yes, exactly. Maybe the bird and Ann Coulter can have a political debate later. I just love this bird. Every once in a while, we just take it out and, like, talk to it and move it around. Because we don't have a pet. These are our pets.
I guess it's done talking.
It had its thing. Now, just when you think this thing is done making its chatter and doing its thing, it starts up again.
It's a bird Furby.
It
seems so fragile because that head mechanism is very lightweight. It seems like it would break apart in a minute.
I don't even remember where we got this. So that was that, yeah. So do you have anything else to show?
I think we're getting close to time, because you have to go to work today, don't you?
I have to work today, yeah. It's been an hour.
It's been an hour? Okay, cool.
So, yeah. This is just a fraction of the toys that litter our apartment.
And there's even stuff in storage, right?
Yes.
And nerds out there, you know, nerds and gay and not, it'd be nice if you tweet
your own little finds.
Tweet us pictures of your toys.
Things you are unashamed to admit you still own, even though you're 51 or 52 or whatever year old gay man or woman.
Yes. You can tweet us.
Yes, please. Please tweet us, like that bird. Although not quite as robotically. We are at GayNerdLove. Yeah. You can follow us there.
I don't know if I can bring it up. There you go. Yes, tweet us at GayNerdLove.
Or follow us and read what we tweet there. We are pleased to retweet lots of tweets.
All the projects that Bad Maria Productions...
of which GayNerdLove is just
creates,
one.
GayNerdLove is one. You can find them at...
That's our website. That's the
BadMariaProducts.com.
The mothership
So that's where all our live streams, all our recorded projects are, all the material.
Videos of us trying to fly, like, radio-controlled planes and shit like that.
If you want to go straight to YouTube.
Yes, please subscribe to our channel where this is.
Yes, subscribe. We always forget to say subscribe. I wish I said it at the top of the show.
And if you click on the little alarm, the little bell when you subscribe, it will send you an email whenever we are live or whenever we post something.
Yes, subscribers get notified when we are on the air.
Correct.
And, of course, the ubiquitous...
GayNerdLove website, GayNerdLove page, the Facebook... You're not somebody unless you have a Facebook page. We do have a Facebook page, and I try to keep posts up there as frequently as possible, especially when we're out playing pinball or just doing stuff, or when we even find stuff at Goodwill, sometimes we'll throw up a picture of it. Even if we don't buy it, we'll throw a picture up and say, hey,
if you don't have Facebook, you're nothing.
Fight yourself.
No, I'm just saying, that's kind of
So
I guess we are ending the show now, baby. Thank you very much. You gotta get ready for your job.
We'll make some coin. We'll make some pinball.
Yes.
So until next week, well, not until next week, but as always, I, Gaynard, love you, Archie.
Gaynard, love you, Andy. Gaynard Love is a project of Bad Maria Productions. We really don't have to do this.